speaking unto Saul that the son of the soul of Jonathan was knit with the soul of David, and Jonathan loved him as his own soul. Now, in the business that, in the ministry that God has put me in, or brought me another aspect of ministry, in the casting out of devils, in Jesus' name, we do something, breaking soul ties. Soul ties can cause us many problems. It says the soul of Jonathan was knit with the soul of David. Anybody in here knit? Once you knit something, you can try very hard to pull that thing apart. It's not going to pull apart. You could rip a fabric, but things that are knit are almost indestructible. And this is what happened. This was a good, we would call this a good soul tie. In your marriage, you have a good soul tie with your husband. Hopefully. There could be some things needing to be cast out of that so that you can have a good soul tie with your husband. But it said that the soul of Jonathan was knit with the soul of David. In verse 3, then Jonathan and David made a covenant. See, a soul tie is a covenant. I'll tell you an example of an evil soul tie. Let's say you work with somebody and they just cannot stand you. They don't want to be around you. They talk bad about you and you don't even know why. But it's usually a spiritual thing. No, always it's a spiritual thing. Because we wrestle not with flesh and blood, right? It's not another person, it's a spirit. Unrighteous people don't like righteous people. So then you begin to have a certain feeling about that person. You know, they're just annoying, getting on your last good nerve. And then you just start avoiding them. You go to the grocery store, they're coming this way, you turn your basket around and go that way. That's an evil soul tie. And here's the strange thing about it. They have power over your life, don't they? I describe a soul tie like a man in a boat fishing. He throws it out. The hook is out there. Now, all the fish are free to swim wherever they want to swim in that lake or wherever you're fishing until it takes the hook. And then that fish has lost authority over its own body. It no longer has total authority over its own self because it's tied to the fisherman now. The fisherman can jerk it this way or jerk it that way or reel it in or let it out. Now it is controlling that fish. That's what a soul tie will do. Some of us have had evil soul ties with our parents. If we had parents that disappointed us or were cruel to us or abandoned us or whatever the case may be, you may have a soul tie, even if they're in the grave. I'll tell you about an interesting soul tie. My cousin's daughter had diabetes. She was diagnosed when she was about 11. We don't have diabetes in our family. We have a lot of stuff in our family, but we don't have diabetes. And I started thinking, why does she have diabetes? She didn't have diabetes last year. Why does she have diabetes this year? My brother diagnosed with bipolar. What happened? He didn't have bipolar 2 years ago. So this cousin, it was the adolescent type diabetes. And are any of y'all familiar with Henry Wright? You ever heard of Henry Wright?
Yes.
He has a ministry in Alabama or Georgia?
Georgia.
Georgia. He wrote a book called A More Excellent Way.
Yes.
He was going to medical school, then he was called into ministry, and he began to see a parallel of some sicknesses with spiritual things. I'll give you an example. Proverbs chapter 6 talks about the man who chases after the harlot. Now, that doesn't have to be, I mean, it can be a spiritual harlotry. It doesn't have to necessarily be a physical harlotry. But it says that if he chases the harlot, he follows like an ox going to the slaughter. I want to read it exactly right. Or as a fool to the correction of the stocks. You know, you see prisoners, they're all chained together. They have no choice but to go where they're led. Till an arrow strike through his liver, as a bird hasteneth to the snare, and knoweth not that it is for his life. It could be the root to liver problems. Adultery. Harlotry. Diabetes. He said, if it's not inherited, it usually is an abandonment issue with the father. Now, I knew that her daddy, my cousin, had had an adulterous affair. And later, when I became friends with his daughter, she told me that when I was 10 years old, my mom and dad separated. Did you know that? I said, yeah, I knew about it. She said, and my mother used to come into my bedroom and dump all of her adult issues on me. As a 10-year-old little girl, she said, I didn't know what to do with all her venom, you know, that she was pouring out about my dad. And it didn't hit me until way later that, oh my goodness, there is the root to the diabetes. The dad had an adulterous affair, left the family. That was the abandonment issue with the father. And then she was diagnosed with this diabetes. Still the only one in our family that has it. But she had she had to have a kidney pancreas transplant about 10 years ago. And of course, that's a whole new set of problems. You know, she's been fighting for her life forever, because once you have a transplant, then you have to fight against the rejection, because the body knows that's not supposed to be in there.
That's right.
But anyway, she came to my mother's not long ago and said, I know what you do in ministry, and I don't think I could tell this to another person and they would understand it. She said, I woke up, they had moved into a new house. She said, I was awakened, and there was a man standing at the foot of my bed. And she said, but not a man, not a real man. I said, I'm with you. I said, did you recognize him? No. He was between the ages of 45 and 50, but he was not pleased with me. There was an anger, and, you know, I wasn't putting it together at the time. I thought, okay. I was thinking, Lord, is there a spirit in the house that was there before they got there? And she told me at the same time that she was going to have to go back in the hospital because her organs were dying. Well, the next morning, I was telling this to a friend of mine, and I heard, ask her who she got her organs from. I said, I'll have to call you back. I called her, and I said, remember the conversation we had last night about the man in the room? I said, who did you get your organs from? She went, oh, Carla, a man between 45 and 50. She said, but I didn't want to know anything about him. I said, well, here's something interesting. I want to break the soul ties between you and that man that you have his organs from. Because he's in the grave, dead. That means death is attached to his organs that you said are dying. Let's break the soul ties. Then I remembered that she had been married before. She also had an adulterous affair. See, like, that's a generational thing. It gets in the bloodline, and then those spirits just travel and do their stuff. So there is a spirit of death, a death sentence attached to adultery. So I broke that. She went to the hospital Tuesday. They were going to admit her and start again dialysis. She went to the hospital Tuesday. They sent her home. She's not on dialysis yet. They put the port in. But listen, these things are so real, spirits. And so I would like to give you an opportunity, if there was anything that was said that caused you to believe that there might be something like this going on in your life, that I would like to give you an opportunity to have that dealt with this morning and have it eradicated from your life and from your bloodline. See, Mephibosheth, he had forgotten who he was. He was the grandson of the king. In fact, he had inherited the castle and all everything, and the servants had taken it over. As Christians, I see that that's what's happened to us. We are like Mephibosheth. We have become lame, and we've allowed someone else to take over what really belongs to us. It's time for that to end. And I believe that the casting out of demons is going to be the last great move, because people are embracing healing, but the casting out of demons is still, nobody wants to touch it. It's not a big deal. It's not rocket science. Jesus is strong enough. He has paid the price for you to be free of anything that is tormenting you. So, how are we going to do this?
Just have everyone stand and do a mass deliverance.
Okay.
Everyone wants to step forward, the person with prayer to write.
Okay, let's do this first. Let's just stand. And I'd like to break the generationally inherited curses that came down through your mother's and daddy's bloodlines. You're not going to see anything happen. This all is done in the spirit realm. But Father, first, right now, in the name of Jesus, I just cover everybody here with the blood of Jesus. I bind every demon that would want to come and distract. That's another real message this morning. Beware of distractions. The enemy wants to pull you away from what God has you focused on. Even good stuff, he doesn't care how he distracts you. Beware of distractions. So, Father, right now, I just want y'all to repeat this prayer with me. Father, in the name of Jesus Christ, I thank you that you hung on the cross. You became the curse so that I could be free of curses. So I bind right now, I bind and break every generationally inherited curse that came down through my father's bloodline. All his infirmities, all of his afflictions, all of his bondages, every weakness, in the name of Jesus Christ, be broken. And I give leave to the familiar spirits that have followed me down my father's bloodline, that want to guide me and direct me away from the things of God. Thank you, Jesus. Father, in the name of Jesus, I bind and break every generationally inherited curse that followed me down my mother's bloodline. All her infirmities, her weaknesses, her bondages, be broken now in the name of Jesus Christ. And I give leave to every familiar spirit.
Yes.
It followed me down my mother's bloodline. To guide and direct me. In a way contrary. From the things that God wants me to do.
And to be.
In Jesus' name.
I bind right now
and break the curse of death
that came down upon me
from Adam and Eve. Because God told them, if you eat of that, you shall surely die. Die means a slow, gradual diminishing of. I bind right now the spirit of it. I break the spirit of infirmity in the name of Jesus. I command every infirmity in this room bow to the name of Jesus. I break that infirmity off of me right now in the name of Jesus Christ. And I apply the shed and resurrected blood of Jesus Christ to my entire body. Thank you, Jesus, that by your stripes I am healed. I receive the finished work of Jesus Christ upon my life and my bloodline in the name of Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you for your shed blood.
Thank you for your shed blood.
Now I bind.
And break the power
of the spirit of fear. Fear is an evil spirit. I command it to leave right now. I break your power off God's people, and I command you to go in Jesus' name. Fear, get out. Get out of God's people in the name of Jesus. For you have not been given the spirit of fear, not a spirit of fear, the spirit of fear, but of power and love and a sound mind. And I receive that right now. I activate the mind of Christ. Because it is written, for ye have the mind of Christ.
Thank you, Jesus.
Thank you, Jesus. Okay, let's do this. Father,
in the name of Jesus,
I break evil soul ties,
with my mom.
The good stuff we'll keep. That doesn't give us trouble. But we break the evil soul ties with our mothers. I send her soul and spirit back to her. It doesn't matter if she's dead either. And I call back my soul and spirit to myself. Cleansed and sanctified by the blood of Jesus Christ. And I ask you to heal my mind and restore my soul. Let me just explain that. If we could see ourselves like a puzzle, whoever you have an evil soul tie with, they take a piece of you. So you're not whole. And you have a piece of them in you, which can cause like multiple personalities, confusion, inability to make decisions because you're not whole. So let's break the soul ties now with our father. I break the evil soul ties with my dad. I send his soul and spirit back to him. And I call my soul and spirit back to myself. Cleansed and sanctified with the blood of Jesus Christ. And I ask you to heal my mind and restore my soul. Now let me tell you, the strongest soul tie that there is sex. That's also the highest form of witchcraft. So if you've had past lovers, you need to break the soul ties with each relationship that you had. Because they still have a piece of you. And you have a piece of them. That explains why you dream about them, or you can't get them off of your mind because you have a soul tie. So, or you may have evil soul ties with your children or with a sister We don't have time to do all of those today, but you get the gist, right? You send their soul and spirit back, call yours back, cleanse and sanctify by the blood of Jesus, and then ask God to heal your mind and restore your soul. Very simple, but powerful. Okay. So I think we're going to stop there. But if there's anybody who would like prayer for something specific, I would be happy to pray for you. And if you want to come forward, you can just come forward. I don't know. Y'all can just be in prayer. Did you want to come? Do y'all want to come? Why don't y'all come stand with me in case there's a word for her or...
Lord.